Hello. Welcome back. I want to start the study with a prayer. Dear God, thank you for this wonderful day, God. Thank you for your word. Thank you for your son. And we just ask your blessing upon the study, Lord, that those who watch or listen to this will be blessed by it and come to a better understanding and knowledge of you and your word. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. All right, now I've been working on this for a while, probably for too long, maybe for a few weeks or so. It seems like each detailed study that I'm doing, I take longer and longer on, but it's been hard for me to focus, and there's a lot to this in some ways. So, anyways, this is part of a larger study on the deity of Christ that I've been working on, and today I'm going to talk about the titles of deity, okay? The name of Jesus and his many titles of deity. And there are lots and lots of titles that affirm the deity of Christ and, you know, the fact that he is God. And so these titles are titles that can only be attributed to God, because if these titles were attributed to a mere man, it would be blasphemy. And so, you know, so they prove that Jesus must be God. You know, there are many, many proofs that Jesus is God. So this is part of a larger study on the deity of Christ, which is part of a larger study on just the doctrine of Jesus Christ in general. I started a while back on a study with the person and natures of Christ. Talked about how he is one divine person with two natures, a human nature and a divine nature. And then I've been going over how proving his divine nature from Scripture and talking about that. And I said that Jesus basically said that he was God, and also the Jews said that Jesus said that he was God. And then I went over and started talking about the pre-existence of Christ, which is pretty connected with the deity of Christ. And now I'm continuing forward on the deity of Christ, and we're going to talk about the name of Jesus and his many titles of deity. And so there's a lot of titles that could be used. I had a lot more. I took some out because I kind of already went over some of them, or I'm planning on going over some of them in the future, or some of them I had a hard time understanding or whatever, so I cut them out. I looked for commentaries, some of the best commentaries that I could find for these verses, and to explain how these titles prove his deity. And so it just took a while just to refine these things, and I tried to make it concise and tried to make it short. It's still like 9 pages printed out, and it's going to probably take a little while to go over, but I'll try to go through them quickly. So first of all, I want to talk about the name Jesus. The name Jesus. Okay. The name Jesus. I'm not sure exactly how I'm going to present this, but I'll just wing it as I go along. The name Jesus is a proof that Jesus is divine, because the name Jesus means Jehovah saves. We're going to talk about this just quickly. So Jesus means Jehovah saves. Philippians chapter 2, verse 9 says, "Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him," speaking of Jesus Christ, "and given him," Jesus Christ, "a name which is above every name." A name which is above every name. The name of Jesus. And Matthew chapter 1, verse 21, we read, "And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins." So if we look at a brief history of this name Jesus, and I'm going to go into the Greek and the Hebrew a little bit. Basically, the Old Testament is Hebrew and the New Testament is Greek. And usually I don't talk a lot about the Greek and the Hebrew because, you know, I believe that the King James Bible is inerrant in English, and, you know, we don't have to go into the Greek and Hebrew. But sometimes they can add a little more or help understand, explain some things. So I'm going to slightly go into that here. But anyways, the history of the name in the Old Testament and the Hebrew and Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 44, we see Hosea, the son of Nun. And so I guess the name Jesus, which is in Greek, is kind of derived from Hosea. And Hosea signifies help or salvation. And the name changed in Numbers chapter 13, verse 16, and became Jehoshua or Joshua, which signifies God, our salvation, denoting that the man who bore the name was indeed God's instrument. The Greek form is Jesus, as in Acts chapter 7, verse 45, Hebrews chapter 4, verse 8. See the elevation of the name applied first in Matthew chapter 1, verse 21, which is what I read, that thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. For while Joshua meant, this is he through whom Jehovah shall save his people from their enemies, Jesus's same name, yet with higher significance, meant God the Savior, in the directest application of the words, and not as denoting salvation instrumentally, for he himself shall save his people from their sins. So also Matthew chapter 1, verse 23. So Jesus means Jehovah saves, okay? And it says that he himself will save his people from his sins. So Jehovah saves, Jesus himself is Jehovah. Now, I'm going to move on to another part. And basically I've tried to categorize these and organize these in a good way to go over them. And so first, I hope there'll be enough room. I don't know how I'm doing this. But I want to talk about Lord. In all capital. Okay. Now, Lord in all capitals. Now, I just mentioned Jehovah, and so I kind of skipped forward a little bit. Now I'm going to kind of backtrack and explain a little bit more. So sometimes in the King James Bible, in the Old Testament, we have Lord in all capital letters. And what that means is, in the original Hebrew, we had the letters YHWH. Okay, they had YHWH. So every time in the Hebrew when it says it had this name, which is consists of these letters, YHWH, they put Lord in all capitals in the English. And so there's debate on how this YHWH is pronounced, because technically there's no vowels. It's all consonants. And so some pronounce it as Jehovah, as I said before, Jehovah, or some say Yahweh, and I think either one is acceptable, okay, as long as we're agreeing on what we're speaking about here. This YHWH is also known as the tetragrammaton. It means four letters, okay, it just means four letters. So anyways, where the word Lord is printed in capital letters in our English Bibles, in the original it is Jehovah. Jehovah is that name of God, which denotes that he alone has his being of himself, and that he gives being to all creatures and things. So, in the Old Testament, this is always speaking of God. Okay? And it means the self-existent one. And the reason why I'm saying this is because we're going to see in the scriptures where things that are said of the Lord, Yahweh or Jehovah, the same things are said of Jesus, okay, which would either have to be true or it would be blasphemous. So, for example, Isaiah chapter 40, verse 3. Let's see here. So I'll just, for the first one here, I'll just write these verses down. Isaiah 40, chapter 3, and then for Jesus, we're going to look at Matthew chapter 3, verse 3. So, Isaiah chapter 40, verse 3, it says, the voice of him that crieth in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, all capitals, make straight and the desert a highway for our God. In Matthew chapter 3, verse 3, we read, "For this is he that was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah," what we just read, "saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight." Who is this speaking of? Well, of the Lord. In the original, it is, "prepare ye the way of Jehovah," Lord, in all capitals. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 3, "Christ was coming. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God." Whenever the word Lord in the Old Testament is printed in capitals in our common English Bible, it is Jehovah in the original Hebrew. And the application by the Holy Spirit of what is said of Jehovah in the Old Testament to Jesus Christ, and by the Holy Spirit of what is said of Jehovah in the Old Testament to Jesus Christ in the New is evidence that he is God. So it's saying, "Prepare ye the way for the Lord, make his path straight." And the Old Testament said, "Prepare ye the way for the Lord," Jehovah, speaking of God, "make straight in the desert a highway for our God." And we see that this is a prophecy speaking of Jesus. And so therefore, he is God. Now, let's go into some more of the titles. Let's see what I'm talking about here. I'm talking about titles of deity. We have the Lord of Glory. Okay. Yes, I might as well do everything in all capitals. I don't know. No. We'll actually just not do capitals. Doesn't matter. The Lord of Glory. And so, for this one, we'll have, I don't know, I'm going to end up running out of room here, but Psalm 24:7, 24:10, and 1 Corinthians 2, verse 8, and James 2, verse 1. Okay, so we have the Lord of Glory. In Psalm chapter 24, verse 7, it says, "Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be ye lift up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of Glory shall come in." In Psalm chapter 24, verse 10, it says, "Who is the King of Glory? The Lord," all capitals, "Jehovah of hosts. He is the King of Glory," Salah. And then we see in the New Testament, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 8, "which none of the princes of this world knew, for had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of Glory." And James chapter 2, verse 1 says, "My brethren, have not the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of Glory," with respect of persons. The Lord of Glory, or the glorious Jehovah. Reference seems to be had to Psalm chapter 24, 7, where he is called the King of Glory, and is an argument of his true and proper deity. He is so called because possessed of all glorious perfections, and is the brightness of his Father's glory. The same honor and glory are due to him as to the Father, and the same ascriptions of glory are made to him by angels and men. So Jesus Christ is the Lord of Glory, and therefore he is God, Jehovah. Now, we have Lord, the Holy One. Okay. And I'm probably just going to have to fill up this whole space on these sections because I'm just going to not have enough room. Lord, the Holy One. And that's going to be 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 2. In Acts chapter 3, verse 14. The Lord, the Holy One. 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 2. "There is none holy as the Lord," all capitals, Jehovah, "for there is none beside thee, neither is there any rock like our God." There is none holy as Jehovah, basically, are God. So Acts chapter 3, verse 14, it says, "But ye denied the Holy One and the just, and desired a murderer to be granted unto you." The character of an Holy One agrees well with Christ, both as God or with respect to his divine nature, holiness being a perfection in it, and in which he is glorious, and as man, he being holy in his nature, harmless in his life and conversation, all his doctrines were pure and holy, and so were all his works, and all his administrations, and the discharge of every of his office. And he is the efficient cause and lane of all the holiness in his people. They are sanctified in him and by him, and have all their sanctification from him. Okay. So Christ is the Holy One, you know, in the highest regard, just like Jehovah. There is none holy as the Lord, all capitals, Jehovah. Now, we'll see, Lord above all. Lord, all capitals, above all. And we got Psalm chapter 97, verse 9, and John chapter 3, verse 31. Psalm chapter 97, verse 9 says, "For thou, Lord," all capitals, "art high above all the earth. Thou art exalted far above all gods," above all the earth, above all the gods. John chapter 3, verse 31, "He that cometh from above is above all. He that is of the earth is earthly, and speaketh of the earth. He that cometh from heaven is above all," speaking of the Lord Jesus Christ. He that cometh is Christ. The divine person came from above and assumed a human nature. He that is of the earth is speaking of John, the Baptist, the prophet, prophets, teachers before him and after him. All men are from the earth. Speaketh of the earth means that they are limited. We are all limited in our knowledge and our understanding, but Christ, who comes from above, is above all in character and work and ought to be honored above all. And so, you know, we are inferior to Christ and his understanding and his teaching. He is above all. He is Jehovah, because Jehovah is above all. Now, this is a pretty popular one that you should know if you've been saved for long studying the Bible. Lord, the first and the last. The first and the last. And we got Isaiah chapter 44, verse 6. Revelation, verse 117, Isaiah 48, 12 through 16, and Revelation 22, verse 13. Okay, the first and the last. Isaiah chapter 44, verse 6 says, "Thus saith the Lord," all capitals, Jehovah, "the King of Israel, and his Redeemer, the Lord," all capitals, "of hosts. I am the first, and I am the last, and beside me there is no God." And then we see in Revelation chapter 1, verse 17, "And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead," him speaking of the Lord Jesus Christ, "and he laid his right hand upon me, saying unto me, Fear not, I am the first and the last." In Isaiah chapter 48, verse 12 through 16, "Hearken unto me, O Jacob and Israel, my called. I am he, I am the first, I also am the last. Mine hand also hath laid the foundations of the earth, and my right hand hath spanned the heavens. When I call unto them, they stand up together. All ye, assemble yourselves, and hear which among them hath declared these things. The Lord," all capitals, "hath loved him. He will do his pleasure on Babylon, and his arms shall be on the Chaldeans. I have spoken, yea, I have called him, I have brought him, and he shall make his way prosperous. Come ye near unto me. Hear ye this, I have not spoken in secret from the beginning, from the time that it was. There am I, and now the Lord God, all capitals, and his Spirit hath sent me. Now, and sometimes, I didn't mention this, I didn't really use examples, I guess this example is here. Sometimes we see also in the Old Testament where we'll have Lord not in all capitals, and then we'll have God in capitals. And this will mean, let's see, well, it's like Adonai Jehovah or something like that. Like Lord, I guess Lord in the Hebrew, when it's not in all capitals, means Adonai, I think. And God usually means Elohim. And I'm going to go over both of those later on. But I think that when it says Lord God and God's in all capitals, that God means Jehovah. So it's like Adonai Jehovah or something. But that's just another way that you'll see God in the Old Testament, where it has to be speaking of the Lord. But anyways, Revelation chapter 22, verse 13, I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I am the first and the last, a way of speaking used by God when he is about to comfort his people and remove their fears. See Isaiah chapter 41, verse 4, and is used by Christ for the same purpose here, and so is proof of his true and proper deity and is expressive of his eternity and also of his dignity and excellency. So, next, we have the Lord of Hosts. Lord, all capitals, of Hosts. And we'll see in Isaiah chapter 6, verse 1 through 3, John chapter 12, verse 41, and Isaiah chapter 8, verse 13 and 14, and 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 8. A lot of scriptures here. The Lord of Hosts. Isaiah chapter 6, verse 1 through 3, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Above it stood the seraphims. Each one had six wings. With twain he covered his face, and with twain he covered his feet, and with twain did he fly. And one cried unto another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord, all capitals, Jehovah of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. In John chapter 12, verse 41, we see, these things said Isaiah, speaking of Isaiah, when he saw his glory speaking of Christ, and spake of him. And so I've mentioned this before, that passage that I just read in Isaiah, talking about the Lord of hosts, Jehovah. We later on see in John, the Gospel of John, that he was speaking of the Lord Jesus Christ. So Jesus is Jehovah. And again, in Isaiah chapter 8, verse 13 and 14, sanctify the Lord, all capitals, of hosts, himself, and let him be your fear, and let him be your dread, and he shall be for a sanctuary, but for a stone of stumbling, and for a rock of offense to both the houses of Israel, for a gin and for a snare to the inhabitants of Jerusalem. And then we see in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 8, and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense, even to them which stumble at the word, being disobedient, whereunto also they were appointed. So the stone of stumbling, this rock of offense, is Jesus. And he is Jehovah. Oh, we're running out of space here, but I guess that we got some more. Let's see here. Now we got Lord, the messenger of the covenant. Now I'm not even sure if I was even aware of this, these verses. But I mentioned, and I've made videos on Daniel chapter 9, verse 27, I think, where a lot of people say it's speaking of the Antichrist to come, this guy who makes a covenant with many, or confirms a covenant with many, and we see that the messenger of the covenant is Christ, okay, not a Antichrist boogeyman figure, like in the Left Behind movies. They're just movies, not based on the Bible. It's based on man's imagination, false interpretations. But anyways, the Lord, Jehovah, the messenger of the covenant. And I forgot the verses, so I'll write those down. But all of this is on the website. Just go to Sound Doctrine and Jesus Christ in person and natures, the deity of Christ. So Malachi chapter 3, verse 1, Mark chapter 1, verse 2, and Luke chapter 2, verse 27. And you can go to acceptyoubeconverted.com or kjvforum.com, and you can find all this on there. So, Lord, the messenger of the covenant, Malachi chapter 3, verse 1, says, "Behold, I will send my messenger, and he shall prepare the way before me. And the Lord, whom ye seek, shall suddenly come to his temple. Even the messenger of the covenant, whom ye delight in, behold, he shall come, saith the Lord," all capitals, "of hosts." So I will send my messenger, and he will prepare the way before me. Okay, and the Lord, whom ye seek, shall suddenly come to his temple. In Mark chapter 1, verse 2, it says, "As it is written in the prophets, behold, I send my messenger before thy face, which shall prepare thy way before thee." Okay? So, at Malachi chapter 3, verse 1, it says that he's going to prepare the way before me. And he says, "I am the Lord of hosts. I am Jehovah. And the path is going to be prepared for me." And in Mark, we see that that is speaking of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is Jehovah. In Luke chapter 2, verse 27, we see that prophecy fulfilled when Jesus came by the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus, when they brought in the child Jesus to do for him after the custom of the law. And in Malachi chapter 3, verse 1, it says, "And the Lord whom ye seek shall suddenly come to his temple." Okay. So, the prophecy is quoted in Isaiah chapter 40, verse 3, and Malachi chapter 3, verse 1. The quotation is a prophecy concerning John, the hairbringer of the Messiah Jesus. "I send my messenger." This I and the prophet is spoken of Jehovah, but this Jehovah is the Messiah. So that we have here a true Jehovah Jesus. Okay. Let's see. Well, maybe the messenger, yeah, the messenger of the covenant. So, anyways, we got that. Now, he is invoked as Lord, and I don't know how much room I got. I guess that over here, invoked as Lord. And we got okay. We're going to have Joel chapter 2, verse 32, Acts chapter 2, verse 21, and 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 2. That Jesus is invoked as Lord, all capitals. So in Joel chapter 2, verse 32, it says, "And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be delivered. For in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem, and it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord, all capitals, shall be delivered. For in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem shall be deliverance, as the Lord, all capitals, hath said, and the remnant whom the Lord, all capitals, shall call. Acts chapter 2, verse 21 says, and it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And see, in Joel it says, whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord, all capitals, shall be delivered. And so Acts chapter 2, verse 21, the expression is derived from the way in which prayers addressed to God begin with the invocation of the divine name, Psalms chapter 3, verse 2, Psalm chapter 6, verse 2, etc. From this, it was an easy step to use the phrase as meaning the worshipers of the one God. Genesis chapter 4, verse 26, Genesis chapter 12, verse 8, 2 Kings chapter 5, verse 4. So it's saying, use this phrase, calling upon the name of the Lord, as meaning the worshipers of the one true God. And we see that in Genesis, where it says, you know, then began men to call on the name of the Lord. Those are the sons of God, okay, not angels. So anyways, it is therefore significant that the Christian converts at Corinth are described by the same phrase, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 2. But just as in Romans chapter 10, verse 12, the same prophecy of Joel is beyond all doubt referred by St. Paul to the Lord Jesus. So here the whole drift of St. Peter's speech, the same Jesus who was crucified, was made both Lord and Christ, points to the same conclusion, Acts chapter 2, verse 36. In Joel, Lord, all capitals, is undoubtedly used of the Lord Jehovah, and the word is here transferred to Christ, and its bearing on our Lord's divinity. This fact is of primary importance. In 1 Thessalonians, the name is applied to Christ more than 20 times, but that they did not hesitate to refer to him the attributes and the prophecies which the great prophets of the Jewish nation had associated with the name of Jehovah. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 2, unto the church of God which is at Corinth, to them that are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints, with all that in every place, call upon the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, both theirs and ours. With all that in every place, call upon the name of Jesus Christ as our Lord. As in Corinth, so in any part of Achaia, of which Corinth was the chief city, invocation of the name of Christ not only respects prayer to him, but includes the whole of religious worship. See Romans chapter 10, verse 13. And this being given to Christ and perforated in his name is a very considerable proof of his true and proper deity, for none but God is to be invoked, nor can any but a divine person, one that is truly and properly God, without idolatry, being regarded as the object of religious worship and adoration. So, looks like we're looking at maybe like an hour-long study here, because we're about 20. Oh my, it might be like an hour and a half. Oh, I'm taking a drink. I'm trying to go through this quickly. Just the way it is, I guess. Hope it's all getting recorded. So anyways, this is all I'm going to do for Jehovah, comparing Jesus to Jehovah in the Old Testament, specifically this section. So we got Lord, all capitals, and the Lord of glory. Christ is the Lord of glory. He's the Holy One. He's invoked as Lord, as Jehovah. He's above all. He's the first and the last, the Lord of hosts, and the messenger of the covenant. So, then I might have to look at the messenger of the covenant more. I don't know if we're speaking of John the Baptist or Jesus there, but we can learn from those verses anyways that Jesus is Jehovah. So, anyways, we're going to move on to the next section. I mean, that's a lot right there to prove that Jesus is God. There should be no doubts. that's the goal, to make us stronger in that belief, to confirm it. It's one of the goals. So, next we're going to talk about Lord. That's not all capitals. So, Lord. And I guess in the Hebrew, it means Adonai. Adonai. And in the Greek, it means Kurios. Kurios. That's basically what we see. So, sometimes people can be called Lord, you know, as in a master. You know, there are lords, there are kings. But we're going to see ways in which this is used to where it can only apply to God. It can only apply to deity. So, an interesting one here. I guess we're going to start off with Psalm chapter 110, verse 1, Matthew chapter 22, verse 43 through 46, and Hebrews chapter 1, verse 13. So, Psalm chapter 110, verse 1 says, a psalm of David, the Lord said unto my Lord, the Lord, all capitals, Jehovah said unto my Lord, Adonai, sit thou at my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool. In Matthew chapter 22, verse 43 through 46, he saith unto them, Jesus said unto these Jews, and how then doth David in spirit, speaking of the psalm that I just read, how doth David in spirit call him Lord, saying, the Lord said unto my Lord, sit thou on my right hand, till I make thine enemies thy footstool. If David then call him Lord, how is he his son? And no man was able to answer him a word, neither durst any man from that day forth ask him any more questions. So he being the son of David, Jesus, was also the Lord of David, which he could no otherwise be but upon the account of his divine nature. Okay. So he pre-existed, and so he being a son of David was also the Lord of David. Okay, being in David's lineage, and so, but he was saying, you know, he was the Lord of him at that time. He said, the Lord Jehovah said unto my Lord, sit thou at my right hand until I make thine enemies my footstool. So, Jesus could no otherwise be son and Lord to David, but upon the account of his divine nature. And so, Hebrews chapter 1, verse 13, we see, but to which of the angels said he at any time, sit on my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool? The person speaking is the Lord, all capitals, Jehovah, the Lord said. In the Greek, both the person speaking and the person spoken unto are expressed by the same name, Lord. Only the person spoken unto is not absolutely called so, but with relation to the psalmist, to my Lord. David calls him his Lord, Matthew chapter 22, verse 45. But in the Hebrew, they have different denominations. The person speaking is Jehovah, that is, God the Father. For though the name be often used where the Son is distinctly spoken of, but sometimes, in the same place, each of them is mentioned by that name, as Genesis chapter 19, verse 25, Zechariah chapter 2, verse 8 and 9, because of their equal participation of the same divine nature, signified thereby, yet where Jehovah speaketh unto the Son, or of him, as here, it is the person of the Father, that is distinctly denoted thereby, according as was showed at the entrance of this epistle. Okay, so when it says, the Lord said unto my Lord, It's the Father speaking unto the Son. It doesn't mean that because the first Lord is named as Jehovah, that the second one is not God, it's not divine, okay? It's the Father speaking to the Son. Sometimes we see them speaking, we see both of them spoken of or speaking to one another, and so we have this distinction, okay? So, anyways, let's move on next. This is another one that you should know. And that is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. King of Kings, Lord of Lords. We're going to look at Deuteronomy chapter 10. Verse 17, and Revelation chapter 1, verse 5, and 17, verse 14, okay, that's that. King of Kings, Lord of Lords. Jesus Christ is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We're going to see about that. Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 17, it says, "For the Lord, all capitals, Jehovah, your God, is God of gods and Lord of lords, a great God, a mighty and a terrible, which regardeth not persons, nor taketh reward." Revelation chapter 1, verse 5, we see, "And from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, and the first begotten of the dead, and the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood." The prince of the kings of the earth. So basically the King of Kings. Revelation chapter 17, verse 14. "These shall make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb shall overcome them. For he is Lord of lords and King of Kings, and they that are with him are called and chosen and faithful." And so sometimes in the Old Testament, like in the book of Kings, 1 Kings, 2 Kings, I guess we have certain kings on the earth who were rulers over other kings. So technically, they could be called kings of kings, but not in the absolute sense that is spoken of as Jesus. He is king of all kings, Lord of all lords, throughout all time, throughout history past, throughout the future, any kings that have been or will be. He is the ruler of all. He is above all. So, he is Lord of lords and King of kings. He is so by nature, as God and creator, to whom the kingdom of nature and providence belongs, and by office as mediator, being made higher than the kings of the earth. Hence, he is more than a match for them. They cannot stand before him. This is a reason why he overcomes them, and it cannot be thought it should be otherwise. This Lamb is the Lion of the tribe of Judah, and when he rouses himself and stirs up his wrath and exerts his power, kings and great men flee from him. See Revelation chapter 6, verse 15. This is a proof of Christ's proper deity, the same titles being given to him, the Word and Son of God, as to God himself. Read Revelation chapter 19, verse 16 as well. So, King of Kings, Lord of Lords. You know, there are verses that say that every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. So we're not just talking about he rules over, you know, a handful of kings in some area or something. No, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. He is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. In the absolute sense, he is Jehovah. He is God. Okay? He is God the Son. It's the second person in the Trinity. So, as the Lord of Heaven. So, this would be as the Kurios, or the Lord from Heaven. Speaks of his divinity. And I talked about before about the pre-existence of Christ, how there are verses that say that he was from Heaven, so he existed before the incarnation. And so we're going to go with one verse here, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 47. So 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 47 says, the first man is of the earth, earthly, speaking of Adam. The second man is the Lord from heaven. The second man is the Lord from heaven. As Adam was the first man, Christ is the second man. These two are spoken of as if they were the only two men in the world, because as the former was the head and representative of all his natural posterity, so the latter is the head and representative of all his spiritual offspring, and he is the Lord from heaven, in distinction from the first man who was of the earth, and whose lordship reached only to the earth, whereas Christ is Lord of all, not only Lord of lords below, but Lord of angels and saints above. The whole family in heaven and in earth is named of him, and he has all power in heaven and in earth, and a name above every name in this world and that to come, and is indeed higher than the heavens. This is not to be understood of his human nature, or of his human body, as if that came down from heaven and passed through the Virgin, as some heretics have of old said, as water through a pipe. For though it was conceived and formed in a miraculous manner under the overshadowing of the Holy Ghost from on high, yet was formed out of the manner and substance of the Virgin, and so was of the earth, and was indeed an earthly body supported by earthly means, and at last returned to the earth, and was entered in it. But it is to be understood either of Christ as a divine person, as the Son of God, as Lord of all, coming down from heaven at his incarnation, not by local motion or change of place, but by assumption of the human nature into union with him. Wow, that's a lot, but that's good. So, the Lord from heaven. It's a title that proves his deity. The Lord of the Kurios. Lord of all. Lord of all. He's above all. He's Lord of all. He's King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and he is Lord of all. Acts chapter 10, verse 36. Romans chapter 10, verses 11 through 13. Lord of all. So Acts chapter 10, verse 36 says, the word which God sent unto the children of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ, in parentheses, he is Lord of all. Which is pretty awesome. Like, he is Lord of all. Anyways, Romans chapter 10, verse 11 through 13, for the scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed, for there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek, for the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him, Jesus Christ speaking of. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. He is Lord of all. The commentators do not appear to have given to this most remarkable parenthesis in Acts chapter 10, verse 36, the full attention which it deserves in the first place. It assigns to Christ divine supremacy in language which, though very brief, is as forcible as possible, and secondly, it brings all mankind on a level, because all men stand in the same relation to him. See Romans chapter 3, verse 29 and 30. So, I think in this Romans chapter 10, verse 11 through 13, let me see here. No. What did I do that? Trying to see here. Well, basically, I guess I didn't mention this one, but I just talked about how he's invoked as Lord, as Jehovah. He's invoked as Jehovah. And so in Romans chapter 10, verse 13, it says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So again, that's invoking him as God. And we also see in the verse before that, that he is Lord over all, which also proves that he is God. So it's just like, bam, 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 everywhere, just over and over again. We see that Jesus is God. It's undeniable in Scripture. Now, so that was a smaller section, but now I'm going to go over a little bit larger one, and then we'll be done. It's still going to take a while, though, probably 30 minutes or more on this one. We're going to go over the word God. or Elohim, or Theos. So we got God. We should know that name. God. In the Hebrew, it means Elohim, E-L-O-H-I-M, and in the Greek, it means Theos. This is kind of like how I said before with Adonai, how some humans can be called Lord, but not in those ways, and not in the names of those titles, which I should have went over before I erased them all and done an overview. But anyways, I guess I can look at the notes, but no, we had Lord from heaven, Lord of all, King of kings, Lord of lords. So there was just a few of them in that one, basically. But anyways, in those senses, no human can be spoken of. In the absolute sense. But so in the same way, we see in some verses, not very many, people are called as gods because they're judges, representatives of God. But individually and in the absolute sense, no man can be called God or Elohim or Theos, because then it would be blasphemy. And so, let's see here. Jews have said that the word Elohim, or God, is applied in Scripture to creatures, and therefore cannot be justly interpreted as importing the proper deity of the person to whom it is addressed. But to this, it may be observed that though the word Elohim, or God, is applied to magistrates officially as representatives of the deity, example in John chapter 10, verse 35, it says, if he called them gods, unto whom the word of God came, he called them gods, okay, lowercase g, the judges are basically. It is then used in a secondary and relative sense, and not in the absolute sense as when it is used of the Son. It is nowhere applied to any individual but to Jehovah himself, and that to apply it to any individual besides Jehovah would be blasphemy. Now I'm going to take another drink. Sorry, this is going longer than I was hoping it would, but that's fine. I'm just glad I'm getting it done. We're moving forward. So, I'm going to mostly be looking at the New Testament, but I'm going to start off with this one. Elohim in the Old Testament. We got Isaiah chapter 40, verse 8. And we got 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 25. Okay. In Isaiah chapter 40, verse 8, it says, The grass, the grass withereth, the flower fadeth, but the word of our God shall stand forever. The word of our God, Elohim, shall stand forever. And then in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 25, it says, but the word of the Lord, Kyrios, endureth forever. And this is the word by which the gospel is preached unto you. Now, compare and note that Lord instead of God, which is the reading of the Hebrew or Old Testament, the substitution indicates that Peter identifies Jesus with God. So when he says the word of the Lord endures forever, he means the word of the Lord Jesus Christ endures forever. And in the Old Testament, we have the word of Elohim shall stand forever. And so therefore, Jesus is spoken of as Elohim, as God. Okay? Now, Jesus is called God many times in the New Testament, contrary to what many people might say. And we're going to look at some of these. A lot of these. I mean, outright. Let's just make a note of this. Jesus is called God in the New Testament. Okay, I'm running out of room, being kind of sloppy, not really thinking this out very much, but you should like underline it a few times, okay? He's called God in the New Testament lots of times. For example, John chapter 20, verse 28, and Hebrews chapter 1, verse 8. So, oh, I guess it would be better if I was over here, maybe. John chapter 20, verse 28, and Thomas answered and said unto him, Jesus, my Lord and my God. Thomas said unto him, my Lord and my God, Theos. My Kurios and my Theos, I guess. That's how that would be. But Thomas uttered one of the most profound declarations of saving faith in Scripture. For a Jew to call another human being my Lord and my God was blasphemy under normal circumstances. John chapter 10, verse 33. Yet that is precisely who Thomas believed Jesus was. It is also who John presented Jesus as being throughout this gospel, as God. Both titles were titles of deity in the Old Testament. Thomas had come to believe that Jesus was his Lord in a fuller sense than before, and he now believed that Jesus was fully God. My Lord and my God, said Thomas. Okay. And he was never rebuked by Jesus or anyone else there for saying such. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 8 says, But unto the Son he saith, Thy throne, O God, O Theos, is forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness is the scepter of thy kingdom. This verse is properly considered a proof and indeed a strong one. God, in the singular, was a name never given to any creature, but is expressive of his divine nature and his relation in the deity, being God the Son. So, Hebrews chapter 1, verse 8 says, Unto the Son, Jesus, he saith, the Father said, Thy throne, O God, thy throne, O God, my Lord and my God. Jesus is called God plainly in the Scriptures, in the New Testament as well, and there's even more that we're going to go over. So, let's see, I guess I'll try to keep this stuff up, but we got God, the Word. Okay, God the Word, just like God the Son. John chapter 1, verse 1, very popular one here. John chapter 1, verse 1, God the Word. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Was God. In the previous phrase, John had said that the Word was with God. And lest it should be supposed that he was a different and inferior being, here John states that he was God. There is no more unequivocal declaration in the Bible than this, and there could be no stronger proof that the sacred writer meant to affirm that the Son of God was equal with the Father because, number one, there is no doubt that by the Word is meant Jesus Christ, and number two, this is not an attribute or a quality of God, but is a real subsistence. For it is said that the Word was made flesh, that is, became a human being. So the Word was God, God the Word. That's a title of Jesus, God the Word. Now we'll see the fullness of God. We're looking at titles that could be used to prove God, Jesus' deity. So we got the fullness of God, God the Word, the fullness of God, Colossians chapter 2, verse 9, says, For in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. So basically all the fullness of God. For in him all the fullness of deity dwells in bodily form. The meaning is, But it was not any one attribute of the deity that became incarnate in the Savior, that he was not merely endowed with the knowledge or the power or the wisdom of God, but that the whole deity thus became incarnate and appeared in human form. Compare chapter, John chapter 14, verse 9, John chapter 1, verse 18. No language could therefore more clearly demonstrate the divinity of Christ. Of what mere man, or what angel, could it be used? That in him dwelleth the fullness of the Godhead bodily. So, the fullness of God. He is called the blood of God. Blood of God. In Acts chapter 20, verse 28. Acts chapter 20, verse 28. Take heed therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock over the which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers to feed the church of God, which he hath purchased with his own blood. Which he hath purchased with his own blood, which being the blood not only of a pure and innocent man, but of one that is truly and properly God as well as man, was a sufficient ransom price to redeem the church and people of God from sin, the law, its curse and condemnation, so that this is no inconsiderable proof of the true and proper deity of Christ. God over all. We saw he was Lord over all. He's above all, and he is God over all. God over all. We're going to look at Psalm chapter 45, verse 6 and 7, and Romans chapter 9, verse 5. So, Psalm chapter 45, verse 6 and 7 says, Thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. The scepter of thy kingdom is a right scepter. Thou lovest righteousness and hatest wickedness. Therefore God, thy God, hath anointed thee with the oil of gladness above thy fellows. Okay. Above thy fellows. Well, anyways, Romans chapter 9, verse 5 says, Whose are the fathers, and of whom, as concerning the flesh, Christ came, who is over all, God blessed forever. Amen. Who is over all, God blessed forever. Amen. Here the apostle is most distinctly... Here the apostle most distinctly points out the twofold nature of our Lord, his eternal Godhead and his humanity, and all the transpositions of particles and alterations of points in the universe will not explain away this doctrine. As this verse contains such an imminent proof of the deity of Christ, no wonder that the opposers of his divinity should strive with their utmost skill and cunning to destroy its force, and it must be truly painful to a mind that has nothing in view but truth, to see the mean and hypocritical methods used to elude the force of this text. So, you know, when it says he is over all, it is absolute proof of his true and proper deity. And so, let's see here, the great God and Savior. The great God and Savior. Titus chapter 2, verse 13. My mom's here and I have to unlock the door, I think. So hang on for a second, sorry. Just for a minute. Okay. Try to get finished up here soon. Let's see. Titus chapter 2, verse 13 says, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Okay, by the immensity of his deity, he is the great God. By the graciousness of his office, our Savior. By the glory of his advent, or appearance, looking for the glorious appearance of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Looking for the appearance of who? The great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. So, looking for the appearance of one person, okay? The Son. We see in a couple other verses, 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 14, it says that thou keep this commandment without spot, unrebukable, until the appearing of who? Our Lord Jesus Christ. In 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 7, that the trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and the glory at the appearing of who? Jesus Christ. So again, in Titus chapter 2, verse 13, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of who? The great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. So this is speaking of Jesus Christ being God and Savior. And we also got 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 1. Oops. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 1 says, Simon Peter, a servant and apostle of Jesus Christ, to them that have obtained like precious faith with us through the righteousness of God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Our God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. The clear declaration of the divinity and saviorhood of Jesus Christ is paralleled in Titus chapter 2, verse 13. But note also the exact parallel phrase in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 11. Our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Where Lord must equate with Jesus, thus here God must also equate with Jesus. And there can be thus be no doubt that this is a clear statement of the Godhead of Jesus Christ. Peter is declaring that Jesus is our God and Lord and our Savior. Amen. Okay, just a couple more pages I'm going through, almost finished. The image or the form of God. So the image slash form of God. And we got 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4. And Philippians chapter 2, verse 6. Okay. Now, the image or the form of God. Another title to prove the deity of Christ. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4, it says, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. In respect to his divine nature, his exact resemblance to God, in his divine attributes and perfections. See Colossians chapter 1, verse 15, and Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3. Colossians chapter 1, verse 15 says, who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature. And Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3 says, who being the brightness of his glory, and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high. So it says he's the image of the invisible God, the image of his person, the brightness of his glory, and his moral attributes as mediator, as showing forth the glory of the Father to people. He resembles God. And in him we see the divine glory and perfections embodied and shine forth. It is from his resemblance to God in all respects that he is called his image, and it is through him that the divine perfections are made known to people. It is an object of special dislike and hatred to Satan that the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on people and fill their hearts. Satan hates that image. He hates that people should become like God, and he hates all that has a resemblance to the great and glorious Yahweh. Now, Philippians chapter 2, verse 6 says, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God. The form of God is to be understood of the nature and essence of God, and describes Christ as he was from all eternity. I spoke of this, how it proves his preexistence. Just as the form of a servant signifies that he was really a servant, in the fashion of a man in which he was found means that he was truly and really man. So his being in the form of God intends that he was really and truly God, that he partook of the same nature with the Father, and was possessed of the same glory from whence it appears that he was in being before his incarnation, that he existed as a distinct person from God his Father, in whose form he was, and that as a divine person, or as truly God, being in the glorious form, nature, and essence of God, and that there is but one form of God, or divine nature and essence, common to the Father and Son, and also to the Spirit, so that they are not three gods, but one God. What the form of God is, the heathens themselves cannot be comprehended, they say cannot be comprehended or seen. And so, not to be inquired after, and they use the same word the apostle does here, and now Christ, being in this glorious form, or having the same divine nature with the Father, with all the infinite and unspeakable glories of it. Wow. Okay. We also have, this will be one of the last ones, let me see where I can put it, the true God. The true God. True God. And we got Jeremiah chapter 10, verse 10, and 1 John chapter 5, verse 20. Jeremiah chapter 10, verse 10 says, "But the Lord," all capitals, Jehovah, "is the true God." So Jehovah is the true God. "He is the living God and an everlasting King. At his wrath the earth shall tremble, and the nations shall not be able to abide his indignation." 1 John chapter 5, verse 20 says, "And we know that the Son of God has come, and hath given us an understanding, that we may know him that is true, and we are in him that is true, even in his Son Jesus Christ. This is the true God, the eternal life." So Jesus Christ is the true God. Jehovah is the true God. Jesus Christ is Jehovah. The only things that could be spoken of, deity, okay? The dispute among scholars as to whether this last sentence of this verse is an affirmation of Christ's deity or not may be resolved quite easily, because one, grammatically, there can hardly be any doubt that the true God is a reference to Christ, and two, theologically, it is absolutely in keeping with all that John wrote, both here and in the Gospel, to read it as a reference to Christ. And that is exactly the meaning this writer has always understood as being in the verse, due to the extensive New Testament teaching elsewhere affirming in the most unequivocal manner the deity of the Son of God. We may view the affirmation of Christ's deity here as the climax of John's claim for the person and work of Jesus Christ in this epistle, just as Thomas's exclamation, "My Lord and my God," John chapter 20, verse 28, is the climax of the Gospel. So, Jesus is called God. Okay, or Elohim, or Theos in the Greek. He's called God the Word. He's the fullness of God. He's the image of God. He's in the form of God, the blood of God, God over all, the true God, the great God and Savior. Okay, and I'm sure there are other examples in Scripture. There are a lot more. There are a lot of other titles that I could go over. I went over some already, like Emmanuel. It means God with us. And that was the name for Christ in the Old Testament. It said, you know, the virgin shall bear a son, call his name Emmanuel. The prophecy of Christ means God with us. So, the mighty God in Isaiah, you know, he's called the everlasting Father and the Prince of Peace, and also the mighty God, okay, so, which proves his deity. The Lord of the Sabbath. I said that Jesus said he is the Lord of the Sabbath. So there are tons and tons of other names that could go over. And the next study that I plan to go over is all the I am statements of Jesus. I am the bread of life. I am the great shepherd. I am the resurrection, etc. And how those prove his deity. And so those are kind of titles also. So a lot of these things go into each other. And we can look at them multiple ways, but I'm trying not to cover too much of the same stuff all the time. But it's a good thing to meditate on all these names and all these titles of God and of Jesus. You know, he's Lord over all, he's King of Kings, Lord of Lords. You know, and when we meditate on him, we get kind of different aspects of Jesus. Like, you know, he's the Holy One. He is the King of glory. He is the King of hosts. You know, he is the true God. So it's good. And, you know, I think it's good for prayer to reverence and to worship God and to use his different titles when worshiping and praising him. So, like I said, there's a lot more, but there's a lot here that I went over an hour's worth. So that's that, I guess. So there should be more than enough proofs in Scripture of the deity of Christ, and there's a lot more to go over. I'm not quite halfway through here, but getting close, and I hope that I'll be able to do things quicker and understand things easier as I go forth, and then go into the humanity of Jesus to prove that he was truly man. So, thank God this is done. So thank you guys for watching. Hope you'll let me know what you think. And God bless.